Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of God, most gracious, most merciful, I seek refuge in God from Satan. I have a lot to say. I don't know why, but it all came to my head. And it is very important. I say I have a lot to say, and I was anxious to change the schedule. So when we were ahead of schedule in the morning, and Shahnaz was speaking here, I mean, we decided to change the schedule, right? But this is destiny. It is destiny that I speak now at this time with you, certain people in this hall now. Because when we attempted to change the schedule, what happened? We couldn't do it. And the rain was only here around on the dining hall. There was rain only. The rain and the lighting was only here. So we had to go back to the original schedule, because it is destiny that I speak now. When you go to school and enroll in a course and they find that you are deficient in some information, they send you back to school to take some prerequisites. You go and take physics or physical chemistry, and then you find formulas that have things called differentiation and integration and funny signs, and you don't understand the thing. They say, oh, you didn't take calculus? Say, no. So they send you back to school. So go take some calculus and come back. And this is what happened to us. We were in God's kingdom, and some deficiency was discovered in us. And some fellow creatures suggested that we be flunked, failed, and send them all to hell. And God said, I'm going to send them back to school, give them a textbook. This is the textbook. And then test them. And if they make it, they can come back. Go take some calculus and come back. After making this statement and realizing that we are here in school to take some additional courses, we are receiving a lot of information, and we are going from test to test, I want to congratulate you, most of you, for making it, because you have passed the most difficult test. And the most difficult test is to have one of us, a human being like us, claim that he is a messenger of God. It's a very difficult test, and I can see now why God calls them a sabiqun, those who are the elite of the elite. As-sabiqun, as-sabiqun, the elite of the elite. Because it's a very difficult test, and I myself went through it, so I'm speaking from experience. And God says they are kullatun min al-awwaleen, many from the first generation. We are the first generation. Wa qaleelun min al-akhireen, a few from the later generation. We are the ones who took the difficult test. Many will be jumping on the wagon in the near future, and thousands and millions are going to join us in the future. But they don't deserve as much credit as you. I was staying at Farima and Amir Kulani's house in San Francisco a couple of months ago. And Farima and Amir, like myself, who grew up with the traditional Islam, they told us that Muhammad was the last prophet, the last messenger. But Farima and Amir passed the test. And they accepted me as God's messenger. They looked at the evidence, and they believed me. They actually believed God, because God said, لا يمسه إلا المطهرون. God said that none can touch this book of mine except those who are worthy of it. And they said, since God revealed the miracle of Quran through this man, then he cannot be a liar. And they concluded that God is telling the truth, It's not as easy as I'm telling you now, but it's a difficult test. They passed it very easily. A couple of days later, after I stayed with Karim and Amir, the neighborhood children came to ask, what is that messenger of God? Because Karima and Amir's children went around saying, guess who's sleeping in our house? For the children, for the new generation, now God says he promises al-husna, the beauty, enjoyment, and heaven for all of the believers, but Karima and Amir's children cannot get the same credit as Karima and Amir. These are children, they're growing up, they have no hang-ups. They say, the parents said, this is God's messenger, and we believe it, and for them it's easy. Can you see the difference? So I congratulate you. The test is very difficult. And I said I passed it. I went through it. Alhamdulillah, I did pass it because I am like you. We are in the same boat. I am required also to believe that Rashad Khalifa is a messenger of God. And it took me 8 years. Some of you are probably better than me in that respect. It didn't take you that long, but it took me 8 years. And this gives me a chance to make it up to some of my most beloved friends. Adib, what is Adib? This man is the most curious creature on earth. He's very curious. He knows your grandmother's name by now. You may not know that he knows, but you know, he's very curious. And he comes to me and, he goes in the supermarkets and reads all the pamphlets and all the bulletin boards, everything. He's very curious. And doesn't make it easy, but he comes to me and says, how does the revelation come to you? Do you see Gabriel? What does he tell you? What do you tell him? In what form? And it is very difficult to convey this to him, and I can see the disappointment in his face. He's very dear to me because he's a believer. Firuz Karmali is also a very curious person. Batul will tell you that. Very curious. And he asked me the same question. And he's very, very dear to me, Firuz Karmali. And the disappointment on his face just breaks my heart. You know, I don't know how what to tell him, so I'm going to tell you now. I see the disappointment on Adib's face, and I see it on Firuz's face. I don't know if I can satisfy their curiosity or not, but I try. There is a precedent in the Quran. As you know, Gabriel appeared to Maryam. He told her he was Gabriel. But what did she say? She said, Inni a'udhu bir-Rahmani minka. I seek refuge in God from you. In kunta taqiyya. So she assumed that he is Satan, or an agent of Satan, or something bad. And before we jump to any conclusions, I want to set some records straight. Gabriel is a messenger of God, and he's the messenger who carries the revelations. He's an angel, and God calls him Ar-Ruh al-Amin, the honest bearer of revelation. Ar-Ruh al-Amin. And he is, we may have human visions of Gabriel, and we may convey on him human characteristics. Like, he may say, you're God's messenger. And I say, get away from me, you're Satan. We will think that he'll get mad and say, I'm telling you, you're God's messenger. No, he doesn't. He's very mild, very understanding, very gentle, and very respectful. And he never utters the things that we would utter. Like, I'm telling you, you better do the announcement or listen. It is amazing, of course, God gave them certain powers. They see certain things, and they have a tremendous understanding. The angels do. So they're really angels. The word angels, as we understand it, is very fitting. Now, I went through the test because the way the revelation comes, Firuz and Adib, is that when God is sending information to us, Gabriel seems to just take over my brain completely. And nothing else, I can do nothing else except deal with the piece of information that is coming. So I stated in the perspective one time that Surah Yasin, verse 3, Innaka lamina mursaleen, I stated that most assertively Gabriel told me that Innaka lamina mursaleen, verse 3, applies to you. Surely you are one of the messengers. And I tried to avoid that because it's a very strong statement. And I grew up saying Yasin. I was even told that Yasin is the name of Muhammad. But my brain was taken over, and you are one of the messengers. I say, go away, you're Satan, which is what Mary said. And then a very mild and very gentle debate will go on. Why do you think I'm Satan? Didn't you say, A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim? I will actually say this. I will say, A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim, I seek refuge in God from Satan, the rejected. And I would say, Rabbi A'udhu Bika Min Hamazat Ash-Shayateen, my Lord, I seek refuge in you from the whispers of the devil. Wa'audhu Bika Rabbi An Yahdurun. And I seek refuge in you, my Lord, that they come close to me. And the debate will say, you said these statements, don't you believe God? He protect you. I am not Satan. And this is when Maryam said, I seek refuge in God from you. She said, A'udhu bi Rahmani minka. I seek refuge in the most gracious from you. In kunta takhiya, if this means anything to you, in other words, you will understand what I'm saying if you are really Gabriel. Gabriel appeared to Maryam in the form of a human being. This did not happen in my case. My case is strictly here. So I dismissed the thought, but then I'm totally incapacitated as far as thinking is concerned or doing anything. So I ignore the thought and then say, I'm going to read some Quran. And then I open the Quran and my brain is taken over. You are one of the messengers. Surah Yasin 3 applies to you. So this is, I hope I satisfy at least some of the curiosity of Adib. I know tomorrow we'll come up with some other questions. But it was very difficult. I think I need to make a correction also. I was never asked to make the announcement. I think the way I put it down, I may not have expressed myself. I was never ordered, until the time of the announcement, in the 8 years before that, I was not ordered. But it was implied. Like I said, there is gentleness and mildness, and obviously there was destiny, there was a certain time for the announcement. But I was just told in this fashion, of all the information, that you're God's messenger, and I went on my many ways, saying I will preach the word of God alone, the worship of God alone, we don't need any announcement. They said, okay, fine, okay, I know I'm God's messenger, fine, leave me alone. This kind of thing. And then, in the first conference, Satan wanted to spoil that and jump the gun and do something. And Susan Ray kind of let the cat out of the bag on pure speculation. And then, at that time, because Ismail is here, I'm going to relate his part. Catherine Colton was just telling me that when that happened and there was a big commotion, she went in the room and she found Ismail Barakat and Qasim Ahmad of Malaysia and Mehri and Mahmoud Firouz conferring about this disaster. And Ismail Barakat was pacing the room. He was very angry and he made a statement that Catherine heard, and Ismail is here. He said, I'm going to ask him point blank if he is God's messenger or not. He was whispering, by the way. But Catherine heard him loud and clear. And he was determined to ask me. At the same time, I was praying very hard. I said, please God, don't let anybody ask me point blank, are you God's messenger? Because I would have told them. I would have said yes at the time.
I asked you a question, but you didn't answer me.
What was that? When?
Your name has been mentioned in the Quran many times, in 86. Yes. I said, this is significant. What's your idea about this?
That was correspondence, right?
Yes.
So I didn't answer you. Yes. That was easy. I was in San Francisco, and people were in a lot of turmoil. Many of you were there. And here is this Ismail Barakat, a hard-headed Egyptian, determined, I mean really determined. He let me up to ask me point blank, are you God's messenger? And I was, Catherine said she was watching me, and I was very quiet. So what she didn't know, maybe she knows now, that I was praying very hard. Please God, don't let anybody ask me that question. I don't need anything like this. I'm going to preach your word alone and worship of you alone. Now what happened this night? I'll give you 2 minutes.
You were determined.
Yeah. And we discussed it with Hasim Ahmed. And we had gone to San Francisco to knock down idols. We didn't want any new ones, you see. So we looked through the Quran, and to us, a messenger was one who received scripture. And this guy didn't receive any scripture, not as far as we know. And if he says that he's received scripture, he's a liar. So I was determined to ask him point blank and get the thing over with. And God is my witness. I couldn't open my mouth to ask that question.
Thank you. Sometime later, Ismail was telling me, like, I can't explain why I was so determined to ask you and what made me I didn't do it. So obviously God answered my prayers. And time went by, and I had to make the announcement. And I said some of you may be ahead of me because I really agonized over that khutbah, the sermon on Friday. How will I tell my friends, brothers and sisters, about this announcement? How many of them would I lose? I love them very much. I want them to go with me, inshallah, to heaven. And I dreaded losing any of them. So I had a sleepless night, and then I go for the khutbah on Friday, and very eloquently, as eloquently as I can, I deliver the khutbah, and I tell them that I am ordered to announce that I'm God's messenger. Then I go to Catherine Cotton, for example, and I have to bring to you my condition at the time. Okay, I'm sweating away. What do you think of this, Catherine? She said, "I'll do that all along. What is the big deal?" Then I turned to Mahtasham and Susan, and they said, "What took you so long?" Here I am, I'm out of breath and I'm sweating away. And these guys knew all along. The funniest one, I went to Lori also, she said, "Well, so, what's the big deal? I'm about to die, I have a heart attack or something." And all these guys already knew, somehow, without announcement, just like I knew, without an announcement. The funniest one was Ihsan Ramadan. Where's Ihsan? Raise your hand. Yeah. Ihsan was going to our children saying, "This man is a messenger of God. I know he's a messenger of God, but does he know? How can I break this news to him?" When these guys were ahead of me, and of course I told you what my daughter said, this is the toughest test. It is very tough, and I congratulate you. That's why I went into Lent. To also try to take account of this conference. And I have lost some of my dearest friends because I was subtle. So I'm not going to be subtle. Mahmoud read the verse that says they are merciful among themselves and harsh on the disbelievers. I'm not going to name names. I'm going to be direct and straightforward. after congratulating most of you, there are a few individuals who I'm afraid they go to hell. If they're guided, they will love me for saying this. If they're not guided, they will hate me, which doesn't make any difference. So I was standing in the last line, and Lydia said how nice and smooth the conference is going. And Kathy Robinson took the words out of my mouth and said, it's not over yet. So Lydia almost jumped and said, what do you mean? So I said, yeah, it's not over yet. Wait till you hear me. So I may cause a lot of turmoil. I need to remember the test. Yes, the test is very difficult, but if the person is not a believer, it is amazing how flimsy the test can be, and they flunk. And this happened to some of my dearest friends, because inside their heart, they were not disbelievers, they were not believers. By flimsy, I give you an example. This is not what happened, but it's an example. They will come to the masjid, they will look at the miracle, they will read the translation, they will discuss the matter with me, they will say, worshiping God alone is reasonable, this is what we believe. Following the words of God alone is fine, this is what we believe. Then they go out, and a block away, they meet somebody who tells them, guess what? Rashad Khalifa picks his nose. He says, he does? I will never go there again. That's how flimsy the test can be. You know. I mean, here I'm showing them a miracle that God revealed through us, the believers, a whole bunch of us. And then, for a flimsy reason, they will flunk the test. It's a very difficult test. But then, it reflects their belief or disbelief inside. We had many people come to the mosque, to the Masjid Tucson. They come to the Quranic studies, they come to the Friday prayers, and they would be seemingly good believers. Now this is what actually happens. And then, of course, they have to be tested. Surah 2, verse 2 of Surah 29, where the people think they would be left to say we believe without being put to the test. We will surely test them to distinguish the truthful from the liars. They have to be tested. And it is in my best interest. But I happen to fall in love with people easily, especially when they say we're believers. I was telling you that Adib is very dear to me, Ruz is very dear to me. And I explained to you this matter of revelation, even though it is really impossible to convey. I want to tell you anything. I want everything to be open. I don't want anything to be mysterious. And I don't want you to hesitate. If there's anything mysterious or taboo or something, there's no taboo, there's no mystery. You come forward and ask. But why are they dear to me? It's because they're believers. One of the best advantages of being God's messenger is that I get to know the believers, true believers. It's such an honor, because believers are a rare, precious commodity. God said so in the Quran. God says most people, no matter what you do, will not believe, and most of those who believe will fall in idol worship. So it is in my best interest that people go through the test, and the hypocrites are sifted away. But like I said, I happen to fall in love with these people. So we have these people come to the masjid, appear to be nice, good believers, and then the test. And Satan sent a man who's very eloquent and very clever, a man who does not do the five prayers, claims to be a Muslim, and as he sips his whiskey, he tells them, Rashad Khalifa is bad. It's not exactly he picks his nose, but he doesn't keep his word. He scratches his left ear occasionally. Some flimsy ear, and they say, oh, okay, then we'll not go to the mosque again. So, it reflects, it, it, It hurts me, but again, it explains why I congratulate you for passing the test, the most difficult test, the test of messengership. I don't want to miss anything. I wrote some notes very quickly here. God says, I will divert from my revelations those who are arrogant. And the only reason people flunk this very difficult test is ego. And God goes out of his way in the Quran and repeats that, say, I'm a human being like you. I am a human being like you. And you know what you are. You're not perfect, nor is God's messenger, whoever it is. I'm a human being like you. The key word is like you. But what is God's messenger? It's a person through whom God is sending information. And the messenger himself is required to listen to this information and is required, like you, to look at it and believe it or disbelieve it. And it's the same difficulty that you're going through. But it is information from God. This is why God says, "Man yuta'a ar-rasula khalata'a Allah." Whoever obeys the messenger is obeying God. This doesn't mean idol worship, which is used frequently to flunk some people. You're idolizing Rashad. We know better than that. We're listening to the information that is coming from God. There is another verse that says, "Fala wa rabbika." It's a very strong verse. "Fala wa rabbika." God is saying, "No, by your Lord, fala wa rabbika la yu'minun." They are not believers. "Hatta yuhakkimuka," until they ask your judgment. "Fima shajara baynahum," in whatever opinions they dispute. "Thumma la yajidu fi anfusihim harajan," and then they find no hesitation in them whatsoever. "Mimma qadayta," about your judgment. "Wa yusallimu taslima," very powerful word, "yusallim," submit completely. This, "fala wa rabbika la yu'minu," by your Lord they are not believers. There is a lady from Vancouver, whose name is Christina. She stopped me this morning. Christina, I'm not sure. And she told me, "I believe in God alone. I worship God alone. I believe the Quran alone. I don't believe you're a messenger of God." What did you say? Incident in Vancouver, where privately between her and me, she said, "I don't believe you're a messenger of God." And then when I said it, she came out in public like this and said, "I believe you're a messenger of God." So what were you telling me this morning? Why did? I believe he did, actually. Herbert W. Armstrong was a great man, and I believe he did not believe Jesus was God, the Son of God, and I believe he's a Muslim, myself. Okay, so you're telling me what to do?
Yeah,
I was trying to explain
I want to read the last verse of Surah 58.
Warn him.
Under the subtitle, Run for Your Life, it says, you will not find people who believe in God and the last day, befriending those who oppose God and His messenger, even if they were their parents, or their children, or their siblings, or their tribe. You will not find people who believe in God and the last day, befriending those who oppose God and His messenger. Do you believe I'm God's messenger? Do you do the contact prayer the way I do?
No, you don't.
Does he do the prayer the way I do, Reverend?
No, they don't.
Thank you. Well, if you receive letters in Vancouver from all over the world,
okay.
Okay, can I have them? I will read them. Can I have them? I never do enough for God. And this is one problem. Okay, I'm glad you brought this up, because I remember this satanic principle of do not judge. Okay, I want, let us all be aware of this statement. Do not judge. This, one of the names of this book is Al-Furqan, the criteria, with which we are to judge. This is Satan's most famous principle, and you will hear it every day. Do not judge. By God, we can judge because we have the law. They judge by the human law, and we can judge by God's law. When God says that the disbeliever will go to hell, we can say that the disbeliever will go to hell. When God says you do not find people who believe in God and hereafter befriend those who oppose God and His messenger, and you see some of your most beloved friends breaking this criteria and constantly associating with enemies of God and God's messenger, you have to worry about them. And as I said in the beginning, what I'm about to say, if the people are guided, they will love me for it. If they are not guided, they will hate me for it.
Rashad, are you saying that I'm an enemy because I don't get up and down when I pray? Is that what you're saying?
No, you told me this morning I do not believe you're God's messenger, which is, I don't care about this myself, but you're blaspheming against God. Because God says, none can touch the Quran except those who are sincere. So if you're, in other words, you're saying I'm a liar. If I'm a liar, you know what it means if I'm a liar? It means that I'm a person who does not believe in the hereafter, a person who does not believe that someday you will face God and will be asked, why did you do this, why did you say that?
You're either lying, or you're mistaken, or you forgot. One
or the other. All of them are bad. I'm either a liar, I made a mistake, or I forgot. But this is a very serious, matter. Now, Susan Ray is about to get into the act. Susan comes all the way from Europe to tell the people that she knows better Arabic than me, that my translation is wrong. And therefore, we have to have representation of the other side. And you thought this conference is going peacefully. May I interrupt for 1 second? I need a volunteer to take Farzin, Farima, and Zareen. Zareen to the airport. I'll be with you one minute. Just 1 minute. Do we have a volunteer to take them to the airport?
Yes.
Okay, Eric, gonna take my keys? Otis. I'm sorry, but they have to catch an airplane. Sophie and Raymond and Susanna, I hope you don't mind my frankness, but
Raymond, I know you're striving to make it to heaven.
I think I love you too much, maybe. You've been in this movement from day one. You've been solid, but you associate. In fact, Satan is waiting for you in Vancouver right now. Don't you know that? You know that. You know some enemies of God and God's messenger will be waiting for you in there. And you're going to treat them very nicely. You probably invite them to your house. When I was in Vancouver, you had Lulu McNoon in your house, even though she was blaspheming against me and lying about me. It is this kind of thing. You're doing it out of kindness, Sophie. I'm not attacking you or Raymond. You believe that these are right things.
Everybody was telling me you was a disbeliever.
Who was a disbeliever?
When you was coming to my house,
yes.
Everyone said to me you was a disbeliever.
Who was a disbeliever?
You was.
Oh, okay.
When you arrived at the home, I said, Rashad, you say la ilaha illallah. Even though I was brought up, I was very impressed with Sunni Islam. I said, you say la ilaha illallah, you're welcome in my home, and you don't dare go and stay in a hotel. Yeah. If you remember at that time, we were facing the Saudis at that time. When Lulu Makhlum came to my home, she came and she said that she wanted to see you, and she wanted to meet with you. This hadith thing she wrote, I did not know about it. I explained to you until my phone rang. I discussed it with Lulu. I said, Lulu, you're mistaken. She wanted to meet with you. The way I see it, you guys can meet, and if there was a misunderstanding between believers and listeners, you should be concerned. That's the way I look at it. I never looked at it in the sense that I was supporting a disbeliever.
Well, fine. I mean, see, you can explain it as much as you want.
I can't help worrying
about you when you have people opposing God and opposing God's messenger,
Rashad,
in your house.
When you told me how you felt about it, the girl was on a bus the next day and she was on her way to Alaska. Is this not a fact?
Yes, you're afraid of her. I love you for it. I'm happy. See, this is why I'm doing this. Because I hope you will do this in the future. But you will not associate with them in the future. In other words, you treat them as God wants us to treat them. God says, "Latarkanu, do not lean, latarkanu ila alladhina zalamu," to those who are doing wrong. Susan.
No, I'm just asking you a question, Rashad.
Yes.
Dr. Hasbeth. Was there any mistake? If it was rather for language or interpretation in your first translation of Quran.
The first translation of the Quran is an authorized translation.
Right.
This translation,
I agree with you.
Every word here is the word of God. This is not my word.
No.
This is not my translation, this is God's translation. There are certain things.
Before
we opened the first box of this Quran, I told the people in Masjid Tucson, this is already obsolete. Because God sends His message in stages, even in the original Quran that the Prophet Muhammad delivered.
Right.
And I have many examples to show you. So if you find, I want to share a principle with all of you, that like I said, God says, say, I'm a human being like you, which means I'm not perfect, just like you. I pick my nose, for
you?
Example.
No.
But,
it's not true.
Oh, no.
It's not true, please. He picks his nose.
That's why he's got his nose.
Yes. There's something I want to say. What I want to share with you is, if you see me as a bad person, then it is your tough luck. If you see me as a perfect person, it's because God wants to guide you. Okay? However, the truth is, I'm not a perfect person. But every one of you have gone through this experience. You meet somebody, and you are really dumb and stupid, and you cannot say a thing to this person to help you. And as soon as the person leaves, you remember all the verses in the Quran and the things that you needed. It's tough luck for that person. That person will leave thinking that you're a stupid person. And many times you meet somebody and you will be very eloquent, and all the Quran verses will come, the right, you'll say the right words. And it's because that person, God wants to guide that person. So the way you perceive me depends on whether God wants to send you away or to bring you to the message. This is a very known principle in the Quran. Okay, I'm gonna...
May I ask a question?
Okay. You want to prove that, that I made mistakes in, the, in this translation and the other translations?
No.
Okay, what are you trying to
Rashad
prove?
Khalifa, yes. I was the first one who told all these people that you are the messenger of God, and this can never, no one take it away from you, because it is something which is done. You have brought the key to the mathematical code of Quran. This is absolutely undiscussable.
What?
Okay. I just asked you, because this is getting a very, very dangerous situation. I was the one about 1986 that I swear in front of God that I am going to back you up until my last drop of blood. And this I meant it. But I am going to back up the messenger of God. The messenger means exactly what his message is. Your message is absolutely untouchable. You are the messenger for that message. But the situation is getting very dangerous, because today, I was saying, looking in your in the last edition of Quran you translated, and I found that there was a difference of meaning. And then when I showed this to one person, this person said, do you know better than he does? Exactly what you are saying, that Susan Ray knows better Arabic than I. This is not the point. Because we are human beings, we are able to make mistakes. And this, if I am showing, it's because this edition should be corrected too, as you are doing it now. But the person is dangerous, because this person tells me, if you are saying that this is wrong, you are an unbeliever. This is the danger that I'm talking about. I'm not criticizing you. This is getting very dangerous, Dr. Khalifa. You have got to do something about this. You are the one who said, first is the Quran, and the messenger is Quran. We have got, God says that you have one ummah. It means one line, and this is this
Quran. You're dividing it, Susan. You're dividing the ummah, and this is, everybody knows that. You know, if you're really sincere, and you really worry about the message and the messenger, you will come to me and ask me, because I'm the one who made that change, if I made it.
What change?
Whatever you were asking, showing the person that I made a mistake or made a change.
You're not changing.
You will come to me and discuss it with me, because I'm the one concerned.
This is possible, because you can't be God. God doesn't make
you're subverting. You're subverting the message. You're telling the people, you're putting doubts in their hearts.
I am not. This is the danger, because every time that I said that there might be a mistake, these people, they thought I'm against you. This is ridiculous.
What is the purpose of telling that there's a mistake? Why don't you come to me, and then together I will share it with everybody.
I said it last year.
Susan, if you're not following the Quran, the whole Quran, nothing but the Quran. See, if you're not, Susan, last year you spoke and you said lots of things that are not in the Quran. Our principle here is, if it is not in the Quran, we do not follow it, we do not believe it. If it is not in the Quran, you have to get rid of all those things.
We have got to sit, discuss, and show each other if we are out of Quran or we are not.
He asked them to get married.
brothers, Susan Ray may have some good points, may have some mistakes. Last year, she insisted on a point. She claimed something very strange. That last year, we had a discussion, rough discussion here with you, and one of your claims that now I remember, can you hear me?
Okay.
One of your claims that I remember now, that at the end of 88, somebody will come and from darkness will pass through light. Now, Susan.
Yes.
Last year we had a discussion,
right.
And we discussed on Yom Kippur, and also you made some interpretation on Surah An-Nur, light will come. And I received a letter from you in Turkey, when I was in Turkey. Your claim also, I think you claimed here, I don't remember exactly, but I remember that you claimed that you are very sure at the end of 88, this will come. I don't know somebody, what it is, it will come. Now, I want to change the subject. I want to ask you, what has come? If it is so important, I want to give you a chance, I will ask Rashad to give you a chance, what had come at the end of 88 that should have changed, supposed to be changed, everything in the earth. If this is a mistake, but you made a lot of trouble that time, you were claiming and
why
you were
trouble?
So...
Why trouble? Can't anyone say what you think?
Yes, we discussed this.
This is the only place that we have the liberty from God to speak.
Sure.
And this is what I have hoped.
But I want to point out something.
Will be different from the others.
Okay. If we insist on our mission area, if everybody can subtract a number from Quran, this year will be this. I am sure you must bring in this. Or
you tell
I understand.
Me how to help Susan Ray. I'm not going to believe what you
Let
say.
Me.
Who is going to make you?
Excuse me?
Who's going to make you? Force you? What
no,
else?
Not force, but we are.
Not to get you married.
We are here. Must be. Must agree on subject. And thank you.
I want to make this clear. No, we're not going to subvert anything or think behind anybody's backs. I want to bring everything out. And I want you to know that I love Raymond and Sophie very much. And I know they are believers. There are things I worry about them, like I worry about my brother or sister or parents. I just worry about Raymond. You know, I love you very much, and you know, I want you to be in a vanguard of the believers. But you see, it is also dangerous, because if you're sucked in anything that God does not want you to do, you influence a lot of people around you who may listen to you also.
I can assure you, it took me a lot of struggle and many years to get where I am today, and it'll take something far, far greater than Christine or anything that you may consider evil.
Into my soul. My soul, inshallah, is only going to one place. This is my hope. And I know inshallah God will help you achieve that. I think I better close and maybe leave it to questions for a while. But I want to close with the verse in Surah 49 that says, first of all, I'm not a popularity seeker. I don't care if I'm all by myself. This is God's business. It's not my business. I have nothing to do with it. This is God's business. But it is my duty to share with you this verse that says in Surah 49, "Innama al-mu'minun." Innama is an exclusion letter, meaning the only believers. Innama al-mu'minun, the only believers. Alladhina amanu billahi wa rasuli, are those who believe in God and His Messenger. Thumma lam yartabu, and then harbor no doubts whatsoever. This is the definition of the believer. Now, because of what is happening in our generation, we have a tremendous responsibility. And with it, there is tremendous blessing that will include us in the elite of the elite, but also tremendous responsibility that brings the worst disaster. If I'm right in my assessment of Christy and what she told me this morning, and unless she is saved by God's mercy, she will be the sorriest person on the day of judgment, because she came so close. She's coming very close, they being in the same room with God's message and God's messenger, listening and witnessing. And on the day of judgment, we see this in Surah 57. I'm going to read this and quit. Have you asked the question? When you come so close, it is very dangerous. There are only two extremes in this room. There are only two extremes. The extremely fortunate, those who are fantastically fortunate. And then there is the worst, disbelievers. There is no in between in this room. You're going to go either to the top or to the bottom. And it is your neck. The truth is evident and falsehood is evident. And you make that choice. I'm not interested in numbers or popularity or how many millions. I really don't care. I'm amazed how many people are believing. I'm amazed. I'm gratified. And I'm very happy. Surah 57, starting in verse 15, on that day, on the day of judgment, the hypocrite men and women, these are hypocrite meaning people who claim to believe, but in their hearts they are not believers. The hypocrite men and women will say to those who believe, will say to the elite of the elite, please allow us to absorb some of your light. In other words, we need energy, we need food, we're hungry. Give us some of your food, some energy, some light. It will be said, go back behind you and seek light. A barrier will be set up between them, whose gate separates mercy on the inner side from retribution on the outer side. They will call upon them, were we not with you? Remember that day in Oracle? We were all sitting in the same meeting hall. Were we not with you? And they will answer, yes, you were with us. But you cheated your souls, hesitated, doubted, and became misled by wishful thinking. Until God's judgment came, you were diverted from God by illusions. So you don't, just by being here doesn't mean you're going to make it to the elite of the elite. God does not want wishy-washies or doubtful people. God wants solid believers. I know them and you know them. But there are people that I love very much and I want them all to be elite of the elite. I want you all to be elite of the elite. And I want to end this speech with a happy note. That in this hall here exist the most important people on earth and the most important people in the hereafter for eternity. The elite of the elite, and I congratulate you from my heart. Congratulations. And now, if there are any questions or discussions, just can you give it 10 minutes this night?
Yeah.
We'll have 10 minutes. If there are any objections, complaints, anything unclear, Cecilia?
Okay, let me save time.
And then today, this morning, the same subject.
Yeah, let me save time. I'll tell you what to deal with. You can fly this way and go to Mecca. You can also fly this way and go to Mecca. So both directions are correct. I'm aware that this is west, but especially here on the west coast, we can go this way. It's perfectly all right. However, if you go that way, you'll face the kitchen and the noise. If you face this way, you're facing the state. So it's okay. Don't worry. I never told you, but I'm about to stop.